In the last video, we learned about the basic communication model. Again, we're concerned with how a message gets from a sender or a source to a receiver, like an audience. We'll tweak and add to this basic communication model so that you have a better understanding of the communication event. If you remember Berlow's SMCR model, where you have a sender who encodes a message, that message goes through a channel or a transmitter, and then it gets decoded by the receiver. Again, no feedback in here. A couple of elements I want to bring attention to is that the sender could be a group of people. It could be an organization, as well as the receiver, as alluded to in an audience, could be a group of receivers. There is also the concept that there could be multiple senders. In an organization, for example, you'll often hear through an intermediary, like a supervisor, what your boss wants you to know. So your boss could be a sender, and then as it goes through your supervisor, who is also a sender, and then finally to you, and then you might also be, as a now the receiver, passing that on to other receivers. So you might be passing it on, for example, if information about healthcare comes through your organization, you might be then passing it on to your family for information. In the encoding process, remember that in face-to-face situations, the message is encoded through both verbal and nonverbal communication, as well as through other situations like an audiovisual channel. In decoding, it involves the receiver's use of sensory skills. So again, you are taking information if you're a sender, you're coding it into it, you're putting it into symbols so that it can create a message, goes through a channel appropriately, and then when it gets to the receiver decodes it. Still missing feedback. Now we get to tweak this a little bit, make it a little bit more appropriate to today's standards. While the Berlow model still had a source or a sender, who sends a message to a receiver through a channel, that's all the same. Instead of the encoding process, however, we change the word encodes to behaves, because the word encode implies that you consciously, you intentionally put it into codes so that it could go through the channel and then be decoded by the receiver. But oftentimes we unintentionally code information as well. If you're scratching your head, you might be doing that unintentionally. Yet the receiver will still see that and then decode that into meaning in his or her mind. Another concept that got added to this is noise. Noise is anything that can interfere with the communication process. It can not only affect the channel, which most of the time, if you're thinking about talking to somebody via a mobile phone and you have static, you'll understand how noise can affect the efficiency or the effectiveness of the message. But it also can affect the source and the receiver. There are four basic types of noise, and you'll see that it can be broken down into external and internal noise. External means it's outside of the communicator's bodies. The first is physical noise, which is external. It includes such things as the sound of road construction outside your window that makes it very difficult for you to understand what is being said. And then you've got internal noise. Those are things that happen within the communicator's bodies. The first one is physiological noise. That is physically within the person, such as illness or fatigue. For example, if you have a migraine, you might find it difficult to speak to others, so encoding a message. And you also may find it difficult to understand them or pay attention to them when they are speaking to you. In psychological noise, it also is happening within the receiver, but now this is where you have thoughts of worry. If you are thinking about your next class or how you're going to get this done in the time that you have allotted, then that may interfere with your ability to concentrate as well. If your mind tends to wander when people talk to you, you daydream, then the noise in your head is preventing or interfering with communication. Semantic noise is also internal. This occurs when there's no shared meaning in communication. If you are dealing with a medical professional who is using words that you don't understand, you're not able to understand that because of the words that are being used, then that would be an example of semantic noise. Remember that in the Berlow model, the linear model of communication, there was no feedback. The way this model adapts it is it adds another line underneath. So now the receiver behaves, that sends a message through a channel. It can be the same channel, so there's also the concept of multiple channels. And then it goes to the original communicator who was the source and is now the receiver, and they decode the message. So now we can change the terms of source and receiver to communicator or participant. Let me get back to the concept of multiple channels, however. Let's say that I am communicating to you this way via a video. So the channel in this case would be the internet, or if I'm giving it to you on a DVD, the DVD player in your computer. You can provide me feedback by asking a question in class. So this now is a second channel. The first channel was via the internet or a DVD player, and now the second channel, the one that you send a message to, could be a face-to-face channel. Or it could be an email message, which is again via the internet, but not at the same time. So we have communicators and participants now. While you are primarily playing a receiver role, you are also playing a source role. Now we can color the entire model with the concept of context. Communication is contextual. In other words, communication does not happen in isolation. You have to consider what is going on at the same time, before and after, in order to make sense of the communication event. Interpersonal communication is contextual, meaning communication does not happen in isolation. How you interpret a message depends not only upon how the message was delivered, but the context in which the message or the communication event occurred. There are multiple ways to look at context. Today, we're going to describe them as five different types of context. The first is psychological context, which is that you bring who you are to the communication event. That means your needs, your desires, your values, your personality. And the you here refers to both the senders and the receivers. There's also relational context, which concerns your reaction to the other person, the roles that they play, how you view yourself in relation to the other person. Some scholars call this the mix. If I am speaking to you as a teacher, then that creates an entirely different interpretation of the message than if I am speaking to you as a subordinate and you're my boss. The interpretation is going to be different. You can also talk about the environment, and this is the physical where you are communicating. It has to do with the furniture, the location, the noise level, the temperature, the season, the time of day, perhaps what happened in the political cycle last year, as well as what might happen next year. Related to that is what we call the situational context, the psychosocial where you are communicating. An interaction that takes place in a classroom, for example, will be interpreted very differently than if that same interaction took place in a bar. And finally, you would take into account the cultural context, which are the rules and patterns of communication that are given by or learned by our culture, and oftentimes differ from other cultures. We have learned behaviors and rules that affect the interaction. If you are from a culture where it is considered rude to make long, direct eye contact, out of politeness, you will end up avoiding that type of eye contact. And you will then interpret other people's use of eye contact according to your cultural rules. Quiz time here. How is the concept of feedback included in the revised communication model that we discussed today? What are the types of noise that can affect communication? And can you explain the concept of context as it relates to communication? Now that you have a better understanding of some additional elements in the communication process, we will talk about in the future the types of communication models and some principles and misconceptions of communication.